Welcome to another unit of the ISM course on Statistics 2. In this unit, we're going to talk about the test, or the C-squared test, for stochastic independence. Well, this is one of the possibilities how we could use the C-squared test in testing different relations. We're going to learn in general about three different approaches. Well, that's the first one. That's on testing for stochastic independence. Well, that's something which in part you might already know from earlier lessons on contingency tables, contingency coefficients, something like this. Because as I said, this is a C-squared test. So whenever you know how to calculate C-squared as a statistic, you're more or less more than halfway there already. So if we go here, basically the first idea is getting our test statistic. That's mostly the same with all the tests, finding test statistic. And the test statistic here is, well, so to speak, the C-squared statistic. So we consider here our original values. That's the Nij. That's the values from our original table, the original frequencies. In addition, we calculate so-called expected frequencies. For the expected frequencies, we also need the sum of each row and the sum of each column, as well as the overall number of observations. Then, for each entry in our contingency table, we multiply the sum of the corresponding row with the sum of the corresponding column and divide this by the number of observations. That's what the ni dot times n dot j divided by n means. Well, this gives us the expected frequencies, but well, what are expected frequencies? Expected frequencies, that's the frequency which would occur in this situation if we wouldn't have any kind of relationship. So if all the observations were totally random, it's still adhering to the marginal frequencies, so to the column or row sums. But in general, expected frequency means this is how it would look like if there's absolutely no relation whatsoever between the two variables. Okay, and then, well, basically we compare our situation with the situation where there's no relation whatsoever. And in this, we're going to do for each entry the difference between our observed value and the corresponding expected frequency. So we have Nij minus Eij. This we square and divide by the corresponding expected frequency, Eij. This gives the fraction, which stands behind the two sum signs. Let's hear this part. So for each entry we go actual value minus expected value squared divided by expected value. And then we just sum up all these values for each and for all entries in our contingency table. We calculate them for each entry and sum up all of them. This gives us our C-squared statistic. And well, here the C-squared statistic, that's our test statistic. Well, so far so good, we have our test statistic. Next part would be a reference statistic. The reference statistic here in this case, that's C-squared, large I minus 1, parentheses, times in parentheses, large J minus 1, and then 1 minus alpha. Okay, large I, that's the number of rows in our contingency table. Large J, that's the number of columns in our contingency table. So we take a look how large our contingency table is. From each, the rows and the columns, we subtract 1, multiply this. This gives our degrees of freedom. And then we have 1 minus alpha. Well, alpha, that's the error, or the margin of error, which is allowed for our test. Now we look this up in a corresponding table, which looks, for example, like this. So in the different rows, we have the degrees of freedom, And in the different columns, we have the corresponding 1 minus alpha values. Okay, so far so good. So for example here, in this case, 3 degrees of freedom and 0.95, meaning we had an alpha of 5%. So usually you go with an alpha of 5%, so usually the column which is marked here is also the one relevant for you. Okay, so far so good. I have test statistic, a reference statistic, so now I can turn to making my decision. For this, I'm just comparing the two, and I can say the two random variables are stochastically independent, so have nothing to do with each other, if my test statistic is smaller than my reference statistic. In other words, they have something to do with each other, they're stochastically dependent when our test statistic is larger than the reference statistic. So that's how we can perform our test on stochastic independence. Now we're going to take a look how this looks with a practical example. So for this, we have here, you collected the following data set on gender-specific smoking behavior. Test for a margin of error of 5% if the variables gender and smoking are stochastically independent. So we can mark here our alpha 5%. Now we have here the data. Now already calculated the marginal sum, so the marginal frequency for smoker, non-smoker, and for female and male, as well as the overall number of observations of 200. So we're basically copying this table if we're going with expected frequencies, except that we leave the inner part, so smoker female, smoker male, non-smoker female, non-smoker male blank. And then we calculate here the expected frequencies. As said before, for example, for female smokers, 80 times 100 divided by 200, giving us 40. That was the first expected frequency. Similarly, we can do this here for female with non-smokers. So 120 times 100 divided by 200. Well, the same thing for male and smoker, 80 times 100 divided by 200. And for male and non-smokers, 120 times 100 divided by 200. So now we have the actual frequencies and the expected frequencies. And well, we insert this into our formula to get our test statistic. And this basically was just going actual frequency, 30, minus expected frequency, 40, in parentheses, squared, divided by expected frequency, 40. That was female and smoker. Then we go to the next part, female non-smokers. So the actual number, 70, minus the expected number, 60, in parentheses, squared by 60. Second part, and then we do the same thing for the males as well. So we have four entries. She squared statistic has four different terms. And if we calculate the whole test statistic, we get a value of 8.34. That's our test statistic. So next part, we can turn to the reference statistic. I'm just summarizing here, test statistic, the 8.34. Then for the reference statistic, we need she squared I minus 1, j minus 1, 1 minus alpha. Well, we have a table with two columns and two rows. So I and j are two. So we have 1 times 1, giving us 1. So we have 1 degree of freedom. And we have 1 minus alpha, 1 minus 0.05, giving us 0.95. So we turn to our table, take a look, 1 degree of freedom, so first row, and 0.95, so the corresponding column with 0.95, giving us here a reference statistic of 3.8415. So we note this, and then, well, for the decision, we simply compare these values. The test statistic with the reference statistic, we see here, the test statistic is larger. As I said, whenever the test statistic is larger, this means differences, or here in this case, stochastic dependence. So both of them have something in common, are stochastically dependent. Well, we might imagine this meaning, I said, well, if the test statistic is larger, this always relates to something with a difference. This can be seen with most of the tests, that whenever we go with zero hypothesis, the zero hypothesis usually is equal to, whereas the H1 hypothesis is different from or unequal to. And the zero hypothesis always retained if the test statistic is smaller, and is always rejected if the test statistic is larger. So in other words, it's always difference, which, or the H1 hypothesis, which rules when the test statistic is larger. However, here, if they were equal, if the actual frequencies and the expected frequencies were equal, this would mean that all our observations are randomly distributed. And this translates into the two variables have absolutely nothing to do with each other, so would be stochastically independent. Here, that's the exact opposite case, test statistic larger. So H1 hypothesis, our actual values are different from the random distribution. So here, there need to be some kind of structure underlying these two variables. And this translates into stochastically dependent. And well, that's all there is to this unit. So I hope you enjoyed listening to it. And if you're looking for additional units, feel free to visit the rest of the course or have a look at the corresponding playlist. I say goodbye and see you next time.